Hello, everyone. Welcome to The Net Online. Thank you guys so much for joining us. We're going to kick things off, as we always do, with a short video clip that will correspond with our message today. Be sure to like and subscribe so we can give you future alerts for when we post messages, and drop a comment below. And thank you guys so much for joining us.
Happy birthday, dear Aurora. Happy birthday to you.
A birthday drink for the birthday girl.
Aren't you going to ask for my ID? I might not be old enough to drink.
Oh, I would never ask your age in front of a gentleman.
Jim's no gentleman. Anyway, there's no secrets between me and Jim.
Is that so?
You heard the lady. I will be right back.
This is the perfect birthday drink, thank you.
I remember this day, a year ago. Jim was so looking forward to meeting you.
What? How could he be looking forward to it?
Oh, he spent months deciding whether to wake you up. He couldn't stop talking about you.
Jim woke me up?
Oh, yes. He said it was the hardest decision of his life. But I see it worked out just fine. What?
Did you wake me up?
Yes, I woke you up.
Have you ever felt that way before? When somebody woke you up and you don't want to be woken up? All right. Well, let's pray as we go in the Word this morning. Father, we just thank you today for your involvement. Thank you for the Word of God. Thank you for the gift of the truth that you've given us, that we can be certain, that we can build our lives on. So Lord, today we invite you to come. We embrace the Spirit of truth. We embrace the Holy Spirit of truth as our friend, as our liberator. We pray it in Jesus' name. Amen. All right, guys. So last week, I hit the topic, freedom is not free. It was a Memorial Day, so I was inspired by Memorial Day somewhat. I get more inspired by that than I used to. But I really needed to expand on it a bit. So I went ahead and made it two parts. And this second part, freedom is not free, is why the church sleeps. So I really want us to... So it's like the clip that I showed where the lady had been in the movie plot line. She was in hypersleep or whatever they call it, cybersleep. And she was supposed to be asleep for 100 years or something. And so this guy had woken her up. He was prematurely released from his cybersleep, and he's alone in the spaceship. And so for a year or two, he wrestles, and he sees her, and he thinks, I think she'd be a great companion to me. And so he wakes her up. So that's why she was so upset. You woke me up. And that's sometimes the way people are when they hear the truth comes at them, it kind of splashes in their face, and there's a moment where you're like, wait a minute. And so I think that the church today, the broader church today, is desperately in need of waking up. And that it may, We need to be awakened before it's too late. The church is one of the greatest powers, forces for good that exist on the face of the earth. And I could really just make a case about that. But the entirety of Western civilization, the freedoms that we know, the blessing, the abundance, all of these things are all undergirded by the precepts and principles of freedom that were laid down by the advent of Christianity, especially post-Reformation. So Western Europe as we know it, but all of these things are threatened now. Everything that we've known and treasured and taken for granted, the freedoms that we assume that we'll always have and our children will have, our grandchildren will have, these things are not to be taken for granted today. And so there are many powers that be that would really have their tyranny is in the air, and the suppression of freedom is on the hearts of many that would like. And if you don't believe it, just look over the last 2 years and look at the coordination and the censorship and the shutting down of accounts that on various social media platforms and so forth, the cancel culture, if you will. So all of that is symptomatic of a trend or trajectory to suppress freedom. But we need to stand for freedom. So last week we looked at Israel. Israel was willing to give up its newly found freedom. Remember, they were delivered from Egypt and the bondage of Egypt. And in exchange for their freedom, they wanted to go back to Egypt. They wanted to go back to some of the security, the predictability, the provision that they knew in Egypt. And so we don't value freedom to the extent that would allow us. In other words, we would sell out our freedom, our newly found freedom, we'd sell it all out for provision and security and predictability. And so the question on the table last week was, what is your price on freedom? At what point would you sell out? At what point would you say it's just too hard? And so they said, wouldn't it be better for us to go back to Egypt? So no one should be a greater champion of freedom than Christian believers. The scripture says that we're actually called to freedom. In Galatians, called to freedom, meaning that's where we belong. That's who we're meant to be. It is in the very essence of how God works, and he is a God of freedom. The scripture says where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is liberty, there's freedom. So we need to stand for freedom and work hard to ensure that it remains, but we must wake up. I think our church is pretty awakened, but nonetheless, here I am, encouraging us to stay alert and to wake up. You know, here we have the biblical citizenship class coming up. That's part of the process of waking up, is to become informed, become educated, begin to equip you to be able to respond to a culture that at times can be very hostile to our beliefs and our values. So what I'm going to go over today are four common beliefs held among Christians that cause them to drop their guard, thus becoming ineffective agents for cultural, societal, and even changing the government. Four beliefs. And so look, I could look at, there are other things that keep Christians from speaking out. There are other things besides these four beliefs. For instance, just plain pure cowardice. You know, say a pastor or elders or leaders are wanting to address an issue or say something or take a stand as a church. Say they just need to take a stand to be pro-life, for instance. But they think in the back of their head, I can't really step out. I can't really say what I think or what I believe because certain members of my church will leave. Some of them are pro-abortion or pro-choice. Some of them are going to be offended if I take a stand like that. And so they hold back. So that's just cowardice, you understand. That's just not being willing to take a risk and really to take a hit because you take a stand for the truth. And there are many, many churches out there like that with the leadership. But there are also many churches that do take a stand unapologetically. And for those, we're thankful for every one of them. I'm still trying to identify who those churches are in our community. I know I have probably a list of 15 or so, but how many churches are in our community doesn't mean I really am aware of what they're all doing. But think about it. If we, the Church of God, drop our guard and become passive in the face of tyranny or the threat of tyranny, then we're inadvertently ushering in that very tyranny by our passivity. So here are the four beliefs. I think you'll have fun with this. And you can use it as a checklist. Do I believe this? Do I believe this? Do I believe this? Some of them might surprise you a little bit, but nonetheless, they become kind of a philosophical view or a religious worldview which affect our motivation and how we see the world around us and how we respond to the world around us. And so we definitely need to have our heads straight about this. But number one, of four common beliefs, the belief in the absolute certainty of the final end or the second coming in our lifetime. Now, there is an absolute certainty of the second coming someday. We know that from the Bible. It's a clear biblical teaching. But what I want to do is make sure that when I say that, it's a belief in the absolute certainty of the final end or the second coming in our lifetime. And when I was in high school, we saw all these things happening and we'd look at it. And in my own naivety, I was thinking, yes, Jesus is about to come. I remember being in high school one day and these dark clouds were coming over the campus. And I was like, ooh, it's so looming and dark. And there's this almost sense like maybe the end is about to come. And so there's always been a belief in the church of the imminent return, meaning that Jesus could indeed return at any time. But the other side of that is that we don't know. We really don't know, but yet there is this common belief that somehow it's inevitable that Jesus is going to return. The end will come in our lifetimes. Many believe that according to Bible prophecy, it is all supposed to get worse and worse. So consequently, we become accepting of things becoming worse and worse because we see it as inevitable. Are you following with me here? Because they see it as inevitable, so then we become passive because there's nothing we can do about it. It's all according to the plan. It's all based on prophecy. So what are we going to do? If we had had this belief and it had shaped our policy during World War II, and if the Allied forces had stepped back and said, you know, we can see the prophecies, we can see everything lining up. It looks like the Antichrist and the beast over here, and it looks like, I mean, really, it probably lined up better than it could probably ever have lined up in what we saw in World War II. It was an incredible thing, but if we had taken the approach that, well, this is all happening just like it was supposed to, it's what God prophesied in the Bible. And if we had let that idea influence our war policy, we would all be speaking German right now. Just think about that for a moment. We did not approach it that way. We saw diabolical evil and we did everything in our power to stop it. And that's what we have to do. That was the right posture, and it's the right posture today. Because you don't know. The final end might come in 100 years. It might come in 1,000. You say, well, Pastor, how can you say that? How can you say that? There's so many signs. I don't care. There were so many signs right before World. There were a lot of signs. The early church thought Jesus was coming in their lifetime. And we've been 2,000 years cooking on this. Maybe we don't have it just right. But we have this idea that we can kind of line up all the prophecies and that therefore he has to come within this 10-year period or whatever. And I believe that's a mistake because we don't know. So the key of this belief is a belief in the absolute certainty that you are sure the final end is coming in our lifetime. It changes your posture. It changes your approach in the sense that we just begin to accept because we think, well, the end time is coming, so it's supposed to just get worse and worse and worse and worse until it's just like we're on the edge of Hades itself. It gets so dark and so awful. And so then if it's inevitable, then we just tend to be more passive. Well, it's all supposed to be. Look, I see them make the comments on Facebook. I see people, they'll say, well, you know, after all, this is the way it's supposed to happen. It's all supposed to get worse and worse. If somebody maybe posts something that's gone bad or something that's gotten worse. But I don't believe in inevitability. Luke chapter 19. So let's look at some Bible. So he said, Jesus says, a nobleman went to a distant country to receive a kingdom for himself and then to return. And he called 10 of his own slaves and gave them 10 minas and said to them, do business with this money until I come back. But his citizens hated him and sent a delegation after him saying, we do not want this man to reign over us. This is a very powerful parable. I just am giving you an excerpt of it. So when you have time, read the whole thing. But what I wanted you to get was the idea is that the master is going to return one day. They get impatient, or they don't like the idea, or they don't like the accountability, or whatever it is, but they have a lot of issues. In the process, though, what was the command that Jesus gave the 10 servants? He said, I want you to do business until I return. In other words, carry on. Don't just sit around waiting for me to return. Don't just let everything go to pot, let the whole thing grow over. But you know, the vineyard and so forth. I mean, in other words, keep investing, keep looking for the return, keep doing business. So the Greek there, it's one Greek word. It's the only time it's used in the entire New Testament. I can't even pronounce the word. It's a very long, complex word. But it basically means to carry on business. It means to trade, to do trade. It means to be occupied. So we're supposed to stay occupied. We're supposed to have jobs. We're supposed to be buying and selling and doing whatever we do from a commerce standpoint, but that's the parable, is that you never get to a point where you just relax. So, well, I guess it's just all going to happen, whatever. Okay, so that's the first thing I want you to see. Jesus' concept of how we are supposed to wait. What is our posture supposed to be? We are supposed to be working. Yes, we're supposed to work because the harvest is ripe. Yes, we're supposed to work in the opposition of evil, and I'll get to that in a moment. So Jesus, Matthew chapter 5, verse 13, he says, you, referring to the disciples, he says, you are the salt of the earth. But if the salt loses its saltiness, how can it be made salty again? It is no longer good for anything except to be thrown out and trampled underfoot. Now, many people struggle with this because they say, well, sodium chloride does not lose its saltiness. It's a chemical thing. It never does. But what you have to understand, they didn't get their salt from mining. You know, we have huge salt domes. There's literal caverns that are made that they can mine salt, pure salt, from the earth. In Texas, even, there are gigantic salt domes in the geology underneath and subsurface salt. And so they literally can drill wells into these things. They can tunnel into them and create mines and so forth. It's pure salt. It's ocean salt. What's that ocean salt doing down there? Okay, so you are the salt of the earth. So the idea here is, and so you say, well, what's he referring to? Well, the way they gathered salt was they gathered it as evaporites, meaning that there were flat lake areas and there were places where the water had evaporated and it left behind a crusty salt. But the salt was often mixed with kind of other materials, other calcium carbonates and things like that. And so what would happen is if you took that cake of salt and you used it to preserve your food and things like that, that if it gets wet or if it gets, it can lose the salt. In other words, it's leached out of it, and then all that's left is just the trash from whatever the impurities were in the collection of salt. In case you ever wondered that, that's probably how it went down. I know you wanted to know that. Okay, so I like the way Andrew Wilson, he's a pastor and a writer, put it. He says he had a lot more to say about this, but there were two things that stood out to me when he talked about the salt of the earth. Jesus saying that we are the salt of the earth. The salt is, first of all, and we all use it, and it's been used since, you know, for millennium, as flavoring. So that means that we as believers are meant to be flavoring on the world, the culture, the society around us. We're intended to spread throughout the world. This is how he put it. We're intended to spread throughout the world and enhance it. adding flavor to things that would be bland, drawing out the blessings of whatever is good and providing a contrast by being distinct and different. We are the seasoning. He didn't say we're just salt. He said we're the salt of the earth, meaning that we are meant to spread, we are meant to affect, we are meant to season the entire world. That is the role of believers. We're not supposed to just sit in a hole and hide out in the closet or just be within the four walls of our church buildings. We are meant to be flavoring and seasoning on the world around us. The other thing that stood out in his list, and I think he had five things, but I just focused on two, is the preservation qualities of salt. And the way he put it, salt was the ancient equivalent of refrigeration. If you wanted to stop meat or fish from decaying, you could rub it in salt and make it edible for longer. This was the main reason salt was so valuable. The disciples of Jesus, in this sense, were sent into the world to keep it from decay, preserving its goodness and preventing it from becoming corrupted or ruined. Okay? So it's a simple concept, but the idea is that Jesus is saying, you are the salt of the earth. You are meant to preserve the sanity. You are meant to preserve the ways of God. You are meant to season and preserve and affect the world around you for better. Pretty simple idea. And then following that, he talks about we're the light of the world, and a light should be set on a hill. It shouldn't be under a basket. It should be there for all to see. So this idea that people have often that somehow we're kind of in retreat and that we're passive as a body in the church. And I give you more reasons why people become passive. But Ephesians 5:27 says that he might present himself to the church in all her glory. I thought that was a cool picture. He might present himself to the church, present to himself the church in all her glory, the church being us, the people of God, having no spot or wrinkle or any such thing, but that she would be holy and blameless. So what you see in an ultimate sense, the church is to be presented to Christ, and that church is supposed to be accomplished. It's supposed to be pure. It's supposed to have grown and developed and become something amazing and beautiful, okay? But oftentimes, we get a picture of the church in the end times. It's kind of beaten up and tattered, and we're just holding on, and it's just, Lord, it's getting really bad down here. You got to come. And we have this kind of defeatist mindset. That it's just really so hard. If it doesn't get any harder, you've got to come back soon. And you know there are generations of Christians that probably thought that way, that thought it is so hard right now. Imagine the very few North Korean Christians. You imagine the very few of them that are there must be praying something like that. Lord, just come back. It's so bad. It's so horrible. It's so horrific. Romans 5:17. I love the scripture, but there's this one phrase I wanted to focus on. It says, and believers in Christ, that we shall reign in life. He's not, I don't believe he's talking about reign in the future or reign. We know that we'll reign in the future. We know that we will reign in the afterlife and so forth. There are other passages that just indicate that. But this one is saying that we're meant to reign in life. We're meant to have some dominion over how we operate, how we live our lives, how we overcome as an individual. But not only that, how we live life, how we interact, how we thrive in this life. And that in Christ we should thrive and we reign in life, we rule in life. So the second thing I wanted to say is the myth. The myth that the church fares better under oppressive tyranny and persecution than it does in a free society that is at peace. There are many people, I've heard it many times over the years, this belief that, well, it's all okay if it goes really bad. If we start getting resistance, we start getting persecution, we start getting, pastors going to jail, praise the Lord, this kind of thing, and hey, that's good, the church will be stronger. To a point, it can be stronger until it becomes highly destructive. That's why I have the picture of there, the Roman Colosseum. It's almost hard to imagine the horror of the Roman Colosseum and the Christians for a period. But there's a myth behind this, and that is that the church somehow will do better, so what? So what does it matter? Why not just let it go to Hades in a handbag? What's the point of it if we're all going to do better in the long run? And I'll just tell you right now, no, the kingdom of God will not do better under ruthless tyranny. It never does. There's a couple of rare exceptions. There's a few occasions where the church remains resilient in the spite of persecution, of which we're thankful for. But in a general sense, even in a historical sense, that is not actually what happens. So it's not a comfort to say, oh, well, let it come. Just bring on all the persecution that you've got. We are good. I don't know about you, but there's nothing in me that wants to be persecuted. I mean, are you a glutton for punishment? I mean, do you want to live in pain and discomfort? Want to be suppressed? Lose your job because you didn't, you know, see, we can go on and on with this. But people that believe this, when it's a subtle belief, but when people believe this, it leads people to believe that it is somehow better to see a national collapse into tyranny than to not. Are we out of our minds? Why would we think that? But this is religious nonsense. So let me give you the scripture. You say, oh, I want chapter and verse. Because I know how the church thrived during Rome. Well, yes, it did, despite it all. But you have to remember about Rome is that there were pockets. There were many pockets. There were pockets of persecution, but much of the empire had a lot of liberty. And the church could thrive. There were many years where there's no persecution at all. But for a systematic Roman persecution like under Diocletian, even that was limited as far as hunting down Christians and tracking them down, and it was awful. But what I want you to understand, it's not like we often picture it, that, well, all of Rome, Christians were all being hunted. It wasn't like that. There were pockets of freedom, and that's one of the reasons they could thrive so well. So in 1 Corinthians chapter 2, verses 1 through 4, he says, I urge then, first of all, that requests, prayers, and intercession and thanksgiving be made for everyone, for kings and all those in authority. Okay, so he says everyone, but then he specifies you need to pray for the kings, the people in authority. And what would the result be that we're looking for? What is it we want to pray when we're praying over kings or presidents or a U.S. Senate or whatever is, or a county judge or whatever it happens to be, but people in authority, the kings that are out there? He's saying pray for them for this result. You think he's going to say, pray for them so they'll really come down on you hard and they'll persecute you and hunt you down into the woods and you can barely survive and you're starving. And, you know, you could think that he'd say, yeah, pray that because that would be so good for us. You would think that that's the way they would be praying, the way some people think today. He says, so intercession and thanksgiving be made for everyone, kings and all those in authority, that we may live peaceful and quiet lives. So what's the fun of that? I like peaceful and quiet life. I like freedom. I like not having to look over my shoulder all the time, wondering who's snuck in our meeting and spying on us so they can come after us. He says that we may live peaceful and quiet lives in all godliness and holiness. This is good and pleases God our Savior, who wants all men to be saved and come to a knowledge of the truth. What is he saying? Evangelism, the spreading of the gospel, thrives in an environment of peace and quiet. In the absence of persecution, the gospel will propagate. They knew that. They understood that. And Paul, in writing Timothy, is saying, this is how we need to pray. This is the objective. You have to understand, they did not have a means of recourse against an unjust government. It was unthinkable to them. But what did they have? They had the ability to pray and to stand. Acts 9:31. Then the church throughout Judea, Galilee, and Samaria enjoyed a time of peace. It was strengthened, meaning the church. It was strengthened and encouraged by the Holy Spirit. It grew in numbers, living in the fear of the Lord. You understand that what he's saying is that because there was a lack, an absence of persecution, it was a time of peace. It was a time in which the church could spread in a very rampant fashion. So there's two very powerful scriptures which relate that for us, and so that's why I wonder at times when people are like, oh yeah, well I don't vote, or I don't care, or I don't this. All I want to do is spread the gospel. I'm like, yeah, whatever. Okay, so you're going to be spreading the gospel when we lose all of our freedoms and tyranny is prevailing in our country. Do you think you're going to be spreading the gospel more then than you are now? Let's be honest. I don't think so. So if we're talking about spreading the gospel, then we should be advocating for freedom from tyranny. We should be advocating for responsible government and ethical leaders and all those things, you see. The furtherance of the gospel prospers in environments that are conducive to freedom. When there is peace and when there is freedom, and I already mentioned Rome is kind of an exception, but I also explained to you why Rome is an exception. Sometimes people, it's like today, you have certain states, we call them free states, and certain states that are very oppressive. And so, but the kind of the beauty of it, it's not like the whole country is characterized by California and New York. But the fact is, regionally, you have somewhere to escape. You have somewhere that you can go. What was similar in ancient Rome, they had places they could migrate and move that were safer than other places. Jesus gave them permission to do that, by the way. He said, if they reject you in one city, shake the dust off your feet and move to the next one. Sound pretty smart to me. In China, as oppressive and awful as the CCP government is, Chinese Communist Party, they have had also seasons of relaxed freedom. Did you know that there was a period where they were actually building mega churches in China, evangelical churches? And then the government will decide, no, we better clamp down on that. They start experimenting with capitalism and free markets and things like that, but they realize that what comes a bundle, it comes with also freedom in general. But they don't like freedom in general. And so their pendulum that swings. And so what was it, 10, 12 years ago, they started literally leveling all these mega churches, destroying them and raising them, bringing them to the ground, and then re-oppressing the believers. So Saudi Arabia, last I checked, and maybe it's changed, but they have no churches and no synagogues. Zero. Do you think the church was just evangelizing and taking great ground in Nazi Germany with the advent of Hitler? No, I don't think so. I don't think that happened until well after World War II was ended. The Iron Curtain lifts over Eastern Europe, and there is an explosion of Christianity in those Eastern European, what were satellite countries of the Soviet Union. An explosion. Once freedom came, of course, a lot of other crummy things also came, but nonetheless, there was an explosion of Christianity in the freedom. And by the way, the irony of it is that Ukraine was probably affected by that explosion of Christianity as much or more than any other country. Doesn't mean they didn't have plenty of corruption. Doesn't mean they don't have a lot of issues, but they're kind of fledgling. They've got a lot of problems, but they don't deserve what the Russians are doing to these people. So, compare North and South Korea. There's the picture. So when tyranny becomes suffocating and becomes aggressive, when it becomes to such a point that it controls every movement within the population and all information is controlled now by the government, and it would be the end point of communism, the ultimate, I guess, the epitome of really where they want to take us, is North Korea. The people that live in North Korea don't even know what they're missing. They don't even know there's another world out there. You see the border, demilitarized zone there? It was established after the Korean War, and you see South Korea, as a flourishing free market capitalist country that became very Christianized in the last 50 years. Some of the largest churches in the entire world are in South Korea to this day. Really amazing when you figure that it was a largely, you know, Christians probably, what, 50, 60, 70 years ago, probably made up like 1% of the whole population. But look at that. Look at the darkness. It's emblematic of where communism and socialism ultimately wants to take us, is to that kind of darkness. How do you think the church is flourishing in North Korea versus South Korea? The church has flourished in South Korea. It has flourished in the most unparalleled fashion because of freedom. So let's get rid of this idea that somehow we'll be better off. So think about it. Do you think that in a hostile, totalitarian, oppressive regime that you will be bolder to share the gospel? If we're all just honest for a moment, everyone's going to think twice. Oh, wait a minute. You mean if I take a risk and tell that person about Jesus, I might go to prison for the next 20 years? Won't you think twice? The third thing, the belief that our only message should be the pure gospel. In other words, the idea comes with this. It's a very noble idea. To be involved in politics is a dirty business. After all, aren't we all not of this world, according to Jesus? And so what happens is there's kind of this idea or belief that somehow we're more spiritual if our teaching and preaching and so forth, we just stick with the Gospels. I mean, the epitome would this would be the Red Letter Movement, which is fortunately in decline, but it was a kind of a hot movement for young adults and young people for a while, where they felt like, well, we can't handle a lot of the Bible. We kind of choke on a lot of the Old Testament. We choke on many aspects of revealed in nature and character of God. We choke on a lot of the words of Paul. When you talk about Romans 13 and so forth, that the government doesn't carry a sword for nothing but for the punishment of evildoers. Well, that's not Jesus. And so what they did is they said, well, what we can do is we'll just reduce down everything that we teach and preach and believe to the red letters in the New Testament. I mean, it's like one of the most ignorant, misguided, misdirected things to do. Because first of all, they're denying the inerrancy of the entire scripture. There's a lot of problems with it. But they choke on the words throughout the Bible because it doesn't fit their preconceived idea of who God is. This belief, and it may not come out as a red letter position, but there are oftentimes pastors and leaders that will teach and preach only nice Bible messages. Where they get in trouble, where I get in trouble, where all of us get in trouble that are taking a stand, is where we try to apply the scripture into a contemporary world. That's when people get mad. I can teach all day long, day in and day out, just nice Bible lessons. But if I don't apply those Bible lessons into the real world, then people are fine. We have to risk. So why should we apply it? So the Bible is an amazing book. And what we have to understand is that the Bible, God, in the Word of God, has something to say about everything. This is all about worldview. This idea that I should only teach and preach kind of nice messages, is it reflects a failure to understand that Christianity is actually a worldview, that God has something to say to people in government on how government should operate. He has something to say about law as the lawgiver. He has something to say about justice, about medicine and ethics and marriage and family and education and economy. It doesn't matter. Whatever it is out there, God has something to say about it. There's some undergirding principle, some undergirding truth that is conveyed in the scripture that comes to bear on all of these areas. God has a say about everything. The earth is the Lord's and the fullness thereof. You see, so even the environment, God has something to say about it. So I don't know, you know, Pastor, I think that churches need to be careful what they say because they might lose their tax exemption. Okay, so is that just a cover story for cowardice? Maybe. But it's definitely a straw man. Do you realize the Johnson Amendment? There was a whole group of pastors that decided we want to test it in the courts. We want it to go to court. We'll take it to the Supreme Court. We're going to go out there and overtly violate the Johnson's Amendment, and we're going to cross every line in our church, in our churches, and we got about 10 churches to agree to do it, and we're going to do it and say, here we are, come get us. Come talk to us. Come look at what we're doing. We are violating the Johnson Amendment. Are you going to take our tax-exempt status? And guess what? No government entity in the entire country would pick up the case. Why is that? Is the church that sacred to them? It's because the Johnson Amendment has no teeth. It has no constitutional muster. And it's never been tested in court, and no one has ever lost their tax exemption because of the Johnson Amendment. But it's a smoke and mirrors thing. And for whatever reason, I've heard it for years, pastors would say, well, no, we just can't do that. It's a violation of separation of church and state. Well, that's dumb. Was John the Baptist violating the boundary between church and state when he tells Herod it's not lawful for you to have your brother's wife? Oh, no, you can't do that. That's a violation of the Johnson Amendment. No wonder he lost his head. But it's noble. We're just going to center on Jesus only. We're going to teach, you know, it sounds noble, it sounds virtuous. We're just about Jesus. The Old Testament, eh. Other stuff in the New Testament, eh. We're just focusing on Jesus. Doesn't that sound wonderful? But it's not right. Because we take the entire Scripture. I like the way Martin Luther said it. How are we doing? Okay. Martin Luther says, it is the truth which is assailed in any age which tests our fidelity. If I profess with the loudest voice and clearest exposition every portion of the truth of God, except precisely that point which the world and the devil are at the moment attacking, I am not confessing Christ. However boldly I may be professing Christianity, where the battle rages, there the loyalty of the soldier is proven. And to be steady on all the battlefronts besides is mere flight and disgrace if he flinches at that point. I love the way Bonhoeffer put it. Silence in the face of evil is evil itself. God will not hold us guiltless. Not to speak is to speak. Not to act is to act. Of course, Bonhoeffer was executed by the Nazis on April 9th, 1945. He actually became allegedly a part of an underground movement, allegedly a part of the assassination attempt of Hitler. But somehow he went through a process where he began to realize that he's no longer a pacifist. That diabolical evil must be stopped. Number four, this one I'm just going to call it the que sera sera. And this one is very common, but it's the idea that it really doesn't matter anyway, because whatever will be, after all, God is in control. And so it's this general idea that somehow we become passive, we don't get involved in an election, we don't get involved. We just become passive because they think, well, you know, God puts in office whoever he wants. No, he doesn't. There's a lot of evil people that get into power that are not pleasing to God. There are a lot of people that take power illegally that is not of God. Now, you can follow it through the Bible. There are people, there are legitimate authorities and illegitimate authorities. People will lie and cheat and steal to try to take power and keep power. But if we have the attitude that, well, it's all God's in control and it's all happening according to his plan, it's a very terrible mistake to make, because it causes us to be passive. And who knows how many people just said, oh, I'm not even going to vote because it doesn't matter anyway. Simple proverb says this: the hand of the diligent will rule, but the lazy man will be put to forced labor. Pretty simple. He's saying the outcome is determined by your actions. The choices we make affect the outcome. The choices that we make collectively affect the outcome. It involves prayer and diligence, and it can affect the outcome. I could give you text after text after text throughout the scriptures where an outcome is changed or altered because of the choices of someone else. If someone repents, just go look at Jeremiah 18, and God outlines his policies toward nations. If they will repent, then I will change my mind concerning the calamity that I had planned for them. The outcome is changed as a result of the repentance of a nation. So I have a notable thought for you. I'm going to wrap up. For the Christians of the first century, for the first century church, it was unthinkable that they could, through activism, somehow change the structure of the existing government. Paul could have led them to the hopeless cause of the zealots, or at the other extreme, to monk-like isolation. There were no viable choices available to them, and yet we have so many ways to push back against that which is evil. We have so many more tools. We have so many more opportunities as believers today to be able to oppose tyranny without even risking our lives. So to conclude, your freedom for you, which we talked about last week, was obtained with a price. Jesus obtained our freedom with a price. And Jesus came to set men free. Can you stand with me? So hopefully you haven't been trapped in one of those four mindsets. And truly, we know better than to be trapped in the stronghold of fear or cowardice. But as believers, we have to be willing to take a stand and get involved. If you're wondering, well, what can I even do to affect the outcome? I'll give you lots of ideas. There's no end to it. There's very few people who would take me up on it, by the way. We all just want to live peaceful, comfortable lives. We don't want to necessarily think to ourselves, well, you know, the America that we knew is at stake. I mean, the Constitutional Republic is... It may be in another 10 years, it may be literally no more. The protections and safeguards that we're accustomed to may literally go away. But there's no reason for that to happen, because we, the people, there are more of us. And I want to see freedom sustained in our country, because the proliferation of the church and the gospel and all the things that we love and cherish continue unhampered when there is freedom, real freedom. So yes, it's something that we should all be paying attention to, and it's something we need to be awake. We need to be awake. I just have too many problems. I just don't know how I can... Okay. We all have problems. We're all trying to make a living. We're all trying to put it together. We're getting engaged or whatever. I see different people and their things. Lord Jesus, Lord Jesus, Jaren, would y'all come? We have a few minutes, so I just want to wait on the Lord a bit. You have something to share? Okay, all right, okay. All right. Yeah, we'll just wait a second. Thank you, Jesus. You know, I think a simple prayer that every believer should pray is just, Lord, use me. Whatever that looks like, Lord, use me. If you're here this morning, would you just be able to say that in the simplest way? Lord, I don't know exactly what it looks like or how it needs to come together, but in simple terms, Lord, use me. How many would just say, yeah, Lord, use me? Would raise your hand and just say, yes, Lord. Lord, see my hand. Lord, use me. Take my life. Use me. Speak through me. Live through me. May I be salty. May I provide seasoning. May I be part of the preservative of the world that I live in rather than part of the problem. Lord, use us. Use us, Lord Jesus. Thank you, God. Let's just worship a moment. That a prayer this morning. Lifted high in
my love. Be lifted high in my life. Be lifted high in our world. Be lifted high in our love.
Jeanette had something on her heart to share this morning.
Yes. Okay, it's on. Awesome. I'm Jeanette, Glenn's wife. And that was an awesome message. That ought to put fire in your belly.
Yes, that's right.
And fire to burn, to go out. And, well, I oversee the children's programs here at the Net. And lately, or since the winter time, we've been trying to impart to the children giving, specifically giving to in the offering for the orphans, that God has graced us with an orphanage to minister to, right? And our teams go out several times a year to the orphanages, and so we are involving the children in this. And we have not ever before, 10 years, taught them much about giving, like physical money. But you know, the Lord says, train up a child in the way that he should go. And so that's what we're doing right now. I don't know why I've had no conviction about doing it with the kids at a younger before, but I do now. So I have to correct this, because there's not a flow of this happening in our Net kids, 5 to 10 year olds, right? So I am trying with the missionaries that have gone. They've come to share and working in the kids, a heart for the orphan, a heart for giving to the work of God. And so we've sent notes to the parents. And I think we need the parents' involvement in this. So I'm asking that you help your child remember. Margaret came to share about the orphanage this morning. And we also then prayed that the Lord would help them remember. And as she shared, and the kids had some responses that I thought were just an expression. And one of them said, "Oh, we want to have a big offering." One of them said, "Well, my family is trying to save up for a house too. So how do we then give if they're..." And, then somebody else said, "Well, there's this story," and this is your kids, okay? Somebody else said, "There's a story in the Bible about how these rich people gave all this money, but they didn't give all. But the widow gave a little bit, and that blessed God." So they were teaching each other. And then the other thing that blessed me this morning about the kids was... promise handing out flyers with Reba. Wasn't that awesome? Train a child in the way he should go. And it's a good thing. It's God's instruction to us. And so I need your help in training our kids to be more giving, to have a heart for the orphan. And, the other thing that I must mention, is this still on?
Mm-hmm.
I was speaking too loud. Glenn and I have been called to young adults some years ago. And the awesome thing is that is, in many ways, even though I couldn't see it at the time, an answer of prayer that I had, that children would be born into homes where they would learn about the Lord. Mm-hmm. And so many of you have married and are raising your children in the Lord. And this is such a godly thing, so precious to the heart of God and in our calling. And so, but on the other hand, and it's the family structure that it is, that is my prayer. And it's not that you can say, "Oh, I'll take my, this part is important, take my kids to church and they'll learn it." No, it's important that your family expresses the love and the honor that God deserves, so it's imparted to them. That's how it's imparted. And we, as a church or a ministry, we come alongside and support that together.
Right.
And yeah,
right.
Anyway, I think I finished.
Yeah, you did. That's good. Thank you. A I turned it on. Well, it shows red still, so I don't know why it's working. Maybe the battery's low, so. Anyway, I appreciate our pastor's wife. She's awesome. She's not usually coming forward like that, but she works very hard to maintain a quality children's ministry here. And I appreciate her in that faithfulness. So, all right. So I did want to mention, if you're here this morning and a lot of the teaching and things you're hearing, it's possible that someone's here and they don't really know the Lord, that they haven't experienced for themselves the freedom that Jesus offers when we come to Him. And we come to Him on His terms, not our terms. And so that means that we come with a surrender, with a yielding to His will for our lives. And once you have that, then you have the potential multiplied over to affect the world for good as the salt, as the light, with His presence, with His anointing in your life. And so I want to encourage you. I would be love to talk with you if you haven't really settled this part of your life. It's like the most significant thing you can possibly do is, what are you going to do with Him? What are you going to do with God? What are you going to do with Jesus? And that is the most important thing to settle, because it affects everything else. So I want to just place that invitation to you. If you'd like to chat with me or visit with me, I'll be hanging out for a while. And so, Lord, we just thank You today that there's so many here today that just said, Lord, in simple terms, use me. Take my life, just like the song we sang. So, Lord, we commit this time to You in the name of Jesus. Amen.